Chaque fois que je dois dire quelque chose pas absolument banal, je dois parler en anglais. Yeah. And so maybe I'll be in English, otherwise it will be confusion. And so the point which I want to make is that whenever you look in science, speculative science, it is always, there is mathematics behind it, but it may be sometimes invisible because we don't, this mathematics doesn't exist yet. And if, so when you don't see it, there might be two reasons, either what you look because the mathematics is unknown, or what you look is not a science but just something else. Yeah? And so I look at various examples, and the most interesting ones are inconclusive. I brought with me some preprints which on subject I try to pursue, which are not conclusive. I couldn't go far because the mathematics, which I think is needed very far from what we know, but a couple of examples, we can go slightly further. And I will do in a slightly different order from what is suggested in my resume of the lectures, because of the subject which I want. So these are subjects which are kind of, I had made some start related to Mendelian laws. Another will be something about entropy. And a little bit, again, technical aspect, clear, but not so much, it is Poincaré-Sturgeon kind of idea on space. Which, of course, we could, shall I say a couple of words about that. And something will be less well shaped, I'll put them before I've forgotten, which I have on my website, but I brought some when I try to indicate possibilities of in other things. So in two subjects which I believe there is much more interesting and profound development, which I will my only speculate, and I just I wrote some, and these are related to evolution, and this about, I don't know how to say it, learning. Yeah? Where all three subjects, all five subjects are rather mathematical, and here I have pretty good, well, you know, pretty good justification. This is, I shall formulate and explain mathematically, though I don't pursue it too far. And this, I speculated for that reason, I have quite rather long articles, exactly because I just, I don't know the answer, and you can only go around it. So the point is that, kind of say in mathematics, whether internally or externally, when it applies to something, there are two kind of faces to that, yeah, which is completely opposite, yeah? And just even within mathematics itself, and even more so when it applies to something so-called real, yeah, which is what means real actually is a tricky point. Because just with those articles based on quotation taken from various people, and so about reality, there is very good quotation due to Wolfgang Pauli, who says that, who as you know, was working in quantum mechanics, and he was saying that exactly the the hardest thing to understand what reality is. Yeah, you don't know what reality is. You make various physical theories, but how they relate to reality or reality is questionable, and this is also true from many other aspects. Yeah, So this kind of these two related to entropy. These two related to genetics, entropy enters in here is essentially, we actually discuss it in the more quasi-physical context. And well, these two is kind of biological, and this kind of relate to psychology. Coming to psychology again, it's an interesting point about psychology that there is a, if you look at the internet and look at the section, and look for if psychology is a science or it is pseudoscience. And there is a discussion, and there is a very good argument by somebody saying it is not a science in a way science is, but it is true and not true because psychology is sharply divided, though this division not always apparent, into what we can call science and what we can say politics, essentially. This is a kind of practical subject, how people behave, how manipulate people, how people can do. And there are lots and lots of that goes under psychology. And then there is scientific psychology, which has completely different origin and which really is scientific, but it's less kind of in the shadow. It has no, and it's purely quite scientific. And so, but indeed what usually psychologists do, practicing psychologists, certainly from a certain point of view, has nothing to do with science and mathematics, they are completely irrelevant. But if you look at scientific psychologists, and this is essentially psychology of animals, but up to some extent people, and this of course concerns behavior of people, and confusion is these people call themselves scientists, which of course, well, the question of terminology. And so, this about, so yeah, look just at mathematical example, just say, I love two examples saying that, so mathematics has two aspects, as I said of that. One of that is miracles. And one the kind of negation of them, yeah? And being kind of logical, by logic. But again, everything is extremely confusing in the language, yeah? Language is terribly confusing, as just recently somebody pointed out to me. If you have A and B, and whatever they are, I want to show that A greater than B. And where a priori I know B is the best. I know B is the best, but I want to show that A is greater than B. Because B is the biggest and the best. And I'm saying, say best in word, bigger meaning best. And you say, nothing is bigger than best, right? If best is the best, nothing is better than best. On the other hand, A is better than nothing. Therefore, A is bigger than B. No. And this is logic used all the time in speculative philosophy. The kind of core of philosophy, this kind of logic. Language is extremely kind of, and this is a, you know, it's not a mistake of the language, it's kind of, it's a power of the language being so ambiguous and so tricky, yeah? But we must be very careful of that. On the other hand, this is, we want to use it, yeah? So, but coming to mathematics, so what are miracles and what kind of logic? So this part is not, of course, accepted, not common, just from outside mathematics, and even inside mathematics, that mathematics is about impossible things. They start from impossible, and then you have to understand them. And two examples, very old, and I maybe even make three examples. Yeah? They're purely mathematical. Yes, people sometimes smile at them, but, and because it's the same attitude, I look at this mathematics, the same I would like to look at this kind of phenomena. It starts with very naive things. And they, in a way, they're not at all naive. They're much more profound than what we think naive. And historically, I don't know, maybe. As this example, I was saying many times, yeah? Yeah? 2 + 2 = 4. Second, it will be the Pythagorean theorem. Yeah? And the third one will be Archimedes' theorem about what area of the sphere is related to area of a cylinder. And this was understood.
Kind of. So what is miraculous about that? And this is rather recent, yeah, I would say. But actually some theorem emerged. Yeah. I would just, only in the 20th century we fully understood implication of that. So this I postponed, yeah. It is the trickiest one, yeah. Right. So what's so special about 2 plus 2 equals 4? Yeah. It's very different, I'm saying. It's similar. Actually, it's already, yeah, and here is actually this related to this, yeah. Yeah, this was Archimedes' theorem, and this is follows, and this Pythagorean theorem. And of course, if you have something like 3 plus 3 plus 3 equals 6, nothing interesting here, but at least you don't know anything growing out of there. Start with Pythagorean theorem, right? And Pythagorean theorem is you look at school and you give a proof and you think you finished. And this is extremely, I think, confusing way of being presented, because proving the theorem is a trivial aspect of that, and certainly the way it's written is completely misleading, because as you know, the basis of the theorem is the essence of the theorem. Is Hilbertian geometry. Chalk breaks down. That you can define with the sum of squares Hilbertian geometry, and there will be fantastic unitary group operating there. And as we know, this unitary group is the essence of quantum mechanics, which actually linked to this theorem. And this theorem of Archimedes is corollary, by the way, of Pythagorean theorem in a second, as I explain. And where the quantum mechanics enters in a more significant way, which is a collapse of the wave function. So this theorem tells you about something about the collapse of the wave function, how wave function collapses the probability distribution. If you think about that, not in a high school terms, or not in the terms of 19th century mathematics, but in terms of the second half of the 20th century. Right. This is one of the way I want to emphasize. So the way you do, you relax, you think, as if said, Grothendieck would think about this, yeah? Not as like somebody like Hardy would think. I'll come to Hardy in a second, this way I mentioned his name, yeah? From the modern perspective, to a certain point, people in science were thinking in terms of multiplication table. And that's, well, it's not so bad, and just great men had made great contributions, but we can think in a different terms. And this has not been done systematically. You think in terms of modern mathematics, about very simple things within mathematics and outside mathematics, and you come immediately, you see you go somewhere. We don't know exactly where you come. So, now, do you know this theorem, why it's so great? What was actually, this was explained to me once by Michael Ache, is that it is, so remarkable about the theorem and what it has to do with quantum mechanics. It is a momentum map. This projection, if you project sphere to the interval, this map is area preserving, preserves measures, namely up to scaling constant. If you take any band here corresponding to this interval, take the same interval in any other place, corresponding band on the boundary of the sphere will have the same area. And this follows from Pythagorean theorem, of course, from some squares being invariant, right? And this is where it goes next. So the next way immediately related to quantum mechanics, when you have n-dimensional simplex, I'm sorry. So I have to push the buttons or what the hell I do? And there is the map from complex projective space to the n-dimensional simplex. So I put n here. It's not power. Actually, n you have to be. I hate to write. No, this is where the n is. N is not indicator of a power, of course. Yeah. And there is such a map, which is goes via the sphere,
you start with the corresponding sphere of dimension n plus 1. Maybe I put, how we put the right dimensions to I'm sorry, to sphere of dimension to n plus 1 in C to n plus C to, I'm sorry, in C n plus 1. And so this is given by equation sum gi, gi bar equals 1. And you replace each coordinate by this. And then you have, this will be a pi. And then you have sum of pi equals 1, which gives you simplex in the Euclidean space. There is another, and this is this moment map. It's obtained, another way to put it, is the action of the n torus here, right? Torus of dimension n plus 1, yeah? Acts here. This is a quotient under this map. It factors through the simplex. Sphere goes here via Hopf map. It goes there. And the map preserves measure. It's measure preserving map up to normalization. And this exactly it is, this map is what is called a reduction of wave function to the, you forget the phase to the probability measure. So you, and this is, of course, extremely remarkable, powerful thing, just relating convexity in complex geometry. And this is inside, but this is inside with the theorem of, so Pythagorean theorem is the first instance of that. And it contains only gradients of the proof. So if you think about this in these terms, not like a like stupid formula, but you understand what it is, and suddenly the first step, and then you look, you have toric varieties, and they have much more than that. And immediately, some world of mathematics come to you. So before we had this Pythagorean theorem, then that, and then there was 2 plus 2 equals 4. And here I'm saying it's 1 plus 1 equals 2, because it's complex numbers which are involved, of course. So complex numbers are here. And of course, another way to think about complex numbers is to say that when you have what it means being minus, and just you have a real line, that minus meaning rotation by 180 degrees, which was, this very simple thing was not understood till recently. Yeah? For example, I think earlier I didn't quite understand that. You always was kind of figuring why minus by minus gives plus. It was a really big discussion. Yeah, this geometric interpretation is relatively recent. It's post-Eulerian. And so, and the fact that you can stop 90 degrees and have square root of minus 1, and this is a kind of quite recent, then complex numbers come, and just the whole incredible, incredible thing comes. But realizing that is not that obvious. Yeah. I mean, it's too simple in this setting to be miraculous, but this is miraculous, right? This measure projection. So what's miraculous about that? You can say, huh, this formula, you're so used to that. But if you think in terms, what it tells you before you write it in explicit form, it tells you, and I prefer it in three-dimensional shape, right? And this is how it generalizes the general. If you have a segment here, and you project it to three walls, so you have this piece of stick here, and you have projection of the shadow on three walls, you have three numbers of the lengths, and the sum of their squares doesn't depend on position of this stick. And this is a miracle. I mean, why they have squares? Why it would be? And this is existence of symmetries within real numbers. And so it's unclear what is more fundamental. I was saying there were some respectful people who were saying something important about numbers. And kind of the definite statement was made by Maxwell, who kind of said that the whole mathematics and science are about numbers, essentially what he says. But within numbers, there are the symmetries. And Maxwell himself implicitly contributed to the symmetry by introducing this Lorentzian group, yeah, which was inside of his equations. But already this orthogonal group, the fact it is there, it is, in a way, rather inexplicable. Yeah? Yes, of course, we can say, ah, you understand it, but then, of course, there are layer after layer. But what about that? Huh? So this is all kind of preparation for what I'm going to say about relation to science. So what's so miraculous there? And the point is that if you think about this in combinatorial terms, it 2 plus 2 equals 4 is not just this identity. It's the composition of four elements set in two subsets of cardinality 2. And you can do it this way,
this way, right? And this way. Yeah?
There are three ways to do it. If you take for one, it will be one. For two, it will be three. But if you take, say, 3 plus 3 equals 6, here it will be something about 10, I guess. In how many ways you can decompose it. And so, essential thing that 3 is less than 4. It's, here is about complex numbers. It's invisible. It's too simple to see it in this model. It is, of course, there, but it's invisible. But this is a, it's visible because it means if I have 4-element set, I can canonically associate to it 3-element set, namely the set of this decomposition, which means there is a homomorphism, permutation group of 4 elements, the permutation group of 3 elements, which was used in algebra since, I think, Ferrer, yeah, who proved it, or Cardano, I'm confused, who proved that equation of degree 4 reduced to equation of degree 3. Because this group is not simple. It's sort of the, well, if you divide by center by involution, right? This is non-simple group, the only one. All other groups here kind of simple, kind of, yeah. But this is what has this homomorphism here. But then, if you look at the next level, if you think about these groups as wild group of compact Lie group, it tells you that the group, or rather universal covering, of SO4 splits into the sum of 2 SO3. You want to take a universal covering, so otherwise you have problem with spins, yeah? And from that, it follows that, or rather of the corresponding property for the Lie algebra, follows that certain operators split, and which imply that the existence of the self-duality equation, if you look at the equation, variational equation that minimizes square integral of the curvature over bundles over 4 manifolds, because there are 4 manifolds. This corresponding equation, similarly to the Laplace equation in 2 variables, which splits into the square of the Cauchy-Riemann operator, this splits and give rise to the first order equation, which is gauge equation, and then there is Donaldson theory and Seibert-Witten theory, and the whole world of mathematics opens because this something absolutely impossible happens. Yeah, yes, this equation is not supposed to split. If you have general polynomial, just the chance it's being square of a smaller polynomial is nil. However, it happens in this case, it happens to be squared, right, because of this identity, which come from this identity because this group is outgrowth of the permutation group by kind of construction of the Lie groups. And then kind of, well, just certainly, I don't have to advertise much for that. Now I want to use similar logic when it comes back to science, but I have to leave this thing up, yeah? All right. So there may be kind of miraculous thing, and then you want to understand them to put them in, develop them and put them into proper context and hoping something happens, right? And as I said, there are, so this example just I want now to look at from this perspective. Now if we forget about this. Now, this is a kind of most pronounced because it's exactly had this flavor. So what's so, why is this a miracle, yeah? And this is one of the reasons why kind of Mendelian logic was not accepted for quite a while. So the history of this kind of amusing. There were 2 points in history, or 3 points in development, right? So one was, I don't know. So when I write French names, well, with mistakes, so I just say Maupertuis,
Yeah, so it was M1, and then it was Mendel, it's M2, and then there was a third moment that not many people involved. Say Morgan was the most essential one. I could have Morgan M3, okay? Involved in development of genetics. So Mipurti first observed, he was looking at people who had six fingers. You know, sometimes people go with six fingers and have in certain families. And he observed proportion. And I think he observed that their ratio is close to 1:3. And then he was trying to make mathematical theory out of that, which was erroneous, but it was certainly in the right direction. And then Mendel was doing something for pea plants, and he also, this proportion appears. And he may develop what I'm going to explain in a second. And then there was the next level, yes, how Mendelian dynamics breaks. And it was Morgan who developed kind of background for that. Essentially, there were some people who discovered, but essentially it was Morgan. And then his student, Sturchewant, makes kind of remarkable discovery, again, remarkable logically, who discovered new way to think about geometry from mathematician perspective. Right? It is a linkage of genes. And their role. And so this is the fact that these two numbers appear is rather incredible. You can see the certain features and observe that there are proportion in which they appear is 1:3 sometimes. And it's, of course, it's nothing in biology is like that. It's probably 1.3 versus, let's say, 2.7. But for biologists, it means 1:3. And this is quite a kind of right way of thinking, yeah. So there are these integers appearing, and that's, you know, quite and interestingly, now that this similar thing we observed by, say, by Darwin, who overlooked it. And that's, again, as I say, it's quite amusing. So what was happening? So you see that this is kind of formal, but this is a biological phenomenon, that these numbers appear in real systems, and in many kind of biological system, when you look distribution of certain features, and they appear in proportion 1:3, approximately. But amazingly, always kind of closer to 1:3 than something else. And biologists of certain of the time who looked at this, except for Mepertier, who was not a biologist, Mendel, who was not a biologist either, by the way, but say Darwin himself looked at this and just couldn't make sense of that, actually rejecting it as something irrelevant. And interestingly enough, say in Russia there was a school of Lysenko who also rejected it as algebra and not biology. On the other hand, selection principle, this evolutionary championed by Darwin, has absolutely nothing biological to it. It's pure mathematics. But because it's so simple, I mean, because exactly it has no content, biological, it's so easily acceptable, right? It's just kind of trivial, regardless of whether right or wrong. And this is something incredible, which needs explanation. And so both, actually, Mepertier and Mendel has right ideas, but Mendel was much closer to the truth. So what is coming behind it, I just want to say the consequence of that, this is already kind of strange, but then if you follow in the logic of the Mendel paper, I read quite a while ago, I don't remember if he said explicitly, but the conclusion is as follows. So let me give a specific example. You have two fields of flowers of different size, and here everybody white, and here everybody red. In generation after generation, here they're only white, only red, and they're the same species, but they're separated by a mountain wall. And then at some moment it disappears, and there's lots of insects pollinating both ways. And so at the moment it disappears, something happens, and you have here both white and red, and here both white and red. And proportion changes. You have certain proportion p times q, different from the original one, of white and red. And then people like Darwin around him say, aha, there was natural selection, some of them beaten. For example, you have proportion was shifted toward white, or it was shifted toward red, whichever. It changed, there was a selection, it will continue. You take next generation, and nothing happens. It remains the same. This process stabilizes on the first step, and then continues being stable.
It's not exactly that, because there are only fluctuations there, of course. But this is essentially what happens. And this was prediction made by Mendel, for whom it was kind of obvious on the basis of his understanding, and he was developing some algebra. But then till 1908, so Darwin was rediscovered in about something 1988 or something, yeah. People rediscovered his work, but they, not his work, they repeated his experiments and came to similar conclusion, and then they just started referring to Darwin. This also, sorry, to Mendel. And also interesting, why they were referring to Mendel? I mean, they discovered them by themselves, and they pretended, kind of thought they didn't know about Mendel, though his paper was kind of published in a quite readable journal. But the point, there were three groups of people who discovered that, and they started arguing who was the first. And then immediately, of course, they looked at the predecessor and found Mendel. This is how they can, this was how Mendel, it all, this is the only reason we know about Mendel, yeah? Because people were fighting for who was the first. And then they were just doing that, and then read Mendel and realized, which they were, of course, no, not that smart as Mendel, that there is a strange thing, that its formula follows this kind of thing. Yeah? And of course, observing it in nature is not so easy, but this certainly was counterintuitive. Why? You have some natural transformation, and why its square will be equal to itself, yeah? So somebody is important. And then there is a probably apocryphic, maybe not story about Harje, that was playing cricket with his biology colleague, and this, I've forgotten the name of this person, was asking him about that, and Harje immediately figured out what happens. And so, and then he wrote half a page in Nature, and essentially what he was saying that if you he was basically emphasizing it was kind of mathematics or multiplication table type, essentially saying the discriminant of quadratic equation equals AB minus C squared or whatever. And he wrote these formulas, and he was kind of showing his disdain for triviality, what he said, because he didn't understand at all mathematics of that. In my view, he wrote, you know, just people of that time, as we like, there are probably nowadays, like Harje, they were so smart, they immediately see the answer, and then they would never think next, because they were so clear to them. But, and so, now let me explain a little bit that before we go further. So what is mathematics behind it? In fact, I would say it's quite non-trivial dynamics involved, and it is extremely paradoxical to exist. It's indeed very strange, because the map we shall describe will be essentially a polynomial map. And you have a polynomial, and you substitute polynomial with polynomial, degree goes up. So to have, again, the same p is kind of rather impossible, right? When it has a superposition of polynomials, to have polynomial of the same degree is impossible. You may say, because degree must go up. However, this is what will happen in this example. And this means that it's something rather exceptional and rather remarkable must be happening. And if you, even before you just, again, you, yes, this, there is some, whatever Mendel was writing was algebra. So his were algebraic formulas, so they were essentially polynomial. They were normalizing constant, which is certainly quite essential. We come back to that. But now, can it happen in principle that composition of polynomial will be polynomial? The degree will not go up. Just again, imagine, just I want to emphasize asking this question before you understand anything and where they would bring you. Yeah? So let's ask this question in the following terms. So imagine you have space, linear space, say, a real, complex, whatever numbers, and you have polynomial maps such that when you imagine also, just now we are in the context of groups, so imagine they just act, the group generated by this map acts transitive here, and they all got to make finite dimensional space, so degree doesn't go up. So another way to say it, you have a Lie group, you have a map, say, from Rn times Rn to itself, which is a group law, which is polynomial. Is it possible to have? And so what would be the answer? And the answer, of course, we know it is A plus B,
or X plus Y,
is a linear map. Are there others? And of course you say, of course not. As usual, this, well, it's too much, but no. And the answer is, no, it's very simple. It's exactly all newly potent Lie groups. So all newly potent Lie groups, this is conception, comes. It's linked to this phenomena discovered by Mendel, and certainly nobody thought about that in those terms, because nobody would think in those terms of groups. Yeah? But I'm saying this phenomenon is the same which comes to life in the first of the three-dimensional Heisenberg group, which again are essential, as you know, in quantum mechanics. Now the mathematical structure, again, just once you have such a little miracle, it just, you know, this is exactly what I'm saying, hardly overlooked. For him it was so simple, the proof was so simple. It's like 2 plus 2 equals 4, it's simple. But not the question of simplicity, but the question of impossibility. If something impossible, it means something happens and you have to go to the bottom of that. And I shall describe, probably not much today, I start today, this thing concerning this map of Mendel. So I'll start with that and then
go to the next point.
So what was the idea of Mendel? Where this 1 to 3 come from? Again, I think Maupertuis had a similar idea, but I think I'm not certain exactly because Maupertuis is hard to read, yeah. He wrote his text rather short and rather kind of generic, and it's not quite clear to say what he meant, but apparently he meant something else, though in the same spirit. And the Mendel, which is how we read him today, was as follows. There are these genes, and in their particular, whatever they are, but they represent features, and there are certain features representable by genes. For example, if you have flowers and they're always either red or white, and there is nothing, no mixtures, no pink, no mixture, no whatever, poop, so there is a gene responsible for that. It happens sometimes. Again, it doesn't happen often, but even happens rarely, it is remarkable. Yeah, it must be understood that it shouldn't be so. You accept from general physical principle, you accept mixture of all things. Any purity is there. And this discontinuity, this is exactly what made mistake of Darwin and all people following him. They believed in the principle of continuity coming from Leibniz. So Leibniz was insisting that everything in nature is continuous. And this is, of course, was moving him in developing of infinitesimals, and it was a very powerful, very good idea. And this idea has kind of an amusing history, but well, in Western culture, and many things are continuous, but some are not, yeah. And but Mendel has kind of different idea. He discovered the discreteness of inheritance, and how his point was that if there are this sharp separation, so there is something responsible for that. It's called gene, something quite abstract, and moreover, this gene is function of two variables. Whatever these abstract variables, right? They're symbols, but that's kind of, we perceive them as polynomial variables and write this AB. So genes compose of that. And then there is a function, phenotype given by AB. So it means that what we see is not A. You don't see B, you see function of two of them. And this, again, a fundamental point which completely was missed by Darwin and all these people. Yes, this was an essential part of inheritance which makes everything possible. Yeah, without that, all this evolution, of course, is sheer nonsense, as it was presented before Mendel. And then, in this particular example of flowers, this function is color. Yeah? Of AB. And this color may take two values. It may be either red or it may be white. And in this particular instance, this was, again, conjecture by Mendel, its function is very special. It may have
Well, first, you believe this function being symmetric in AB, and you think about this gene, this composition AB coming from your parents, one A from father, B from mother, vice versa. You assume it being symmetric, which is, again, sometimes true, sometimes not. But again, even sometimes being symmetric is quite remarkable, right? Because very strong property. Again, when you think, we assume kind of, you know, just unthinkably, because we're used to them. But in order to see how impossible they are, you have to have more general perspective. And this may only come from mathematics, because there is nothing else. Yeah. This exactly difference of mathematics in common sense. In common sense, we try to associate things with those which we know. In mathematics, we try to produce things which we don't know and relate to them. And this way, common sense is usually nonsensical, right? Because new things cannot be reduced to what we know. And this function is as follows, that you have this A and B, and the rule assumed by Mendel that BB will be white, this function color, and for all others it will be red. So if there is A present, then it will be red. So maybe it's better to change my notation and call them from the very beginning these two components W and R, and say this color equals red unless we have double white. So that's the rule. And just if you assume it, then so why this assumption is reasonable before you do any mathematics? Purely qualitatively, it is quite significant. Because if you have white parents, flowers, all their descendants will be white. But if you have red parents, their descendants may be either white or red.
Yeah? A and B, I think.
I switch from A and B.
A and B, color from A and B?
I switch from A and B to white and V and W, that's easier to remember.
White.
A and B is a generic notation, and this specific notation for this example. So because I never remember who is white and who is red in terms of A and B. This corresponds to A, and this to B, okay? I just change my notations, just not to forget who is who. Yeah. But this annotation, they're not colors. And then they represent, colors are function in two variables. Right? Colors, what you see. Yeah. These are names for genes, for alleles, yeah, whatever they call. But, so there are two, this is a function, and this value it takes, and these are abstract variables, and just I use these letters not to confuse them. Yeah. And if you have red parents, then they may have descendants both white and red. However, if you keep selecting red, always taking red and red and red, eventually you arrive at a population which will be pure red in all generations. And this, of course, what we use people in artificial selection for about 7,000 years. Yeah, this estimate when people start domesticating plants and animals. Or 10,000 years, something like that, yeah? When domestication started. We don't know exactly, but say of order between 10 and 7,000 years. Say 10,000 years. If you start selecting on one particular feature, eventually all descendants will have this feature, if it's simple enough feature, like this red. So this is a preliminary part of the experiment. So if you want to make this experiment, this is how it's done by Mendel, and then of course by Morgan, you select this pure organism, it has always they have descendants of the same type, and then you start mixing them. And then when you start mixing them, you observe this one-third ratio, right? And then explanation again is quite simple. So we have white and red, and you on randomly start mixing them, yeah? You may have either white-white, white-red, red-white, and red-red. So this will be white. This is red, all this will be red. And so there is this ratio 1 to 3. So you assume that everything which may happen is equiprobable.
All things are independent. So again, this is exactly what kind of was the point of Hardy, how he was arguing. Of course, his computation was obvious to him and to anybody. He did kind of multiplication table. In a second, though, I see it as not that kind of innocuous as it looks. But the point that you can represent everything by this kind of maximally symmetric situation, right? To say that some variables equidistributed, so you have unknown quantities. And fantastically, the right assumption in science to say they are equal unless otherwise stated. If you have some numbers coming from some process and they're of the same nature, first conjecture is they are equal, which is mathematically absurd. Generic numbers are not equal, but the right conjecture, they're equal. And then you say they are independent, which means that the appearance of them in pairs also equal. So extend this symmetry to the next step. And again, this is where probability theory starts. It starts from making assumption of something being equal, which is, again, looks opposite to what may happen. Yeah, more likely two numbers to be not equal than being equal. But in fact, we assume they are equal. And there is some reason for doing that, of course. I mean, not common sense, but mathematical reason. And once you make these assumptions, you arrive at this 1 to the 3 ratio, and then you start observing if it actually happens and how plausible it is. And then this interesting controversy, which I haven't followed quite, but it would be interesting, of course, to look more carefully. There was Fisher, Robert Fisher, who was a kind of major figure in statistics and in genetics, mathematical genetics of the turn of the beginning of the 20th century, who, on one hand, he was great fan of Mendel, but he believed that Mendel falsified his data, that it didn't follow from the, in the real world the approximation. Of course, there's this noise, and Mendel kind of selected good examples, and just his conclusion was not justified. And certainly, he was professionally, technically much better equipped than Mendel. He developed really modern statistics very much. Depends on him, and later on I indicate some one remarkable discovery he made, purely mathematical, related to the entropy. On the other hand, recently I read articles saying that Fisher was wrong, and he was making mistakes in mathematics, which Mendel didn't do. Yeah? Because he was a statistician. No matter how he was good, he was a statistician, not quite a mathematician. Yeah? That's probably the reason. I don't know, just if you can read it on the net, articles about Fisher and what he wrote. Anyway, this, guessing this proportion was not at all obvious, yeah, because it was marginally true, yeah. You had to, because there was lots of noise in the data. However, you have it, and now, why would this imply this what is called a Hardy-Weinberg rule, though it was of course known to Mendel, that. So you have this kind of picture. So you have two units determining the gene, right? W and R, and their pairs. Yeah. So this distribution of their pairs. So population given by distribution of their pairs. And then when you take a random mating, so mix everybody together. It may change, but it stabilizes in the second step. Why? There is stabilization, right? And let me explain, to say, go ahead of the explanation. So what is the mechanism of that, which was, in my view, overlooked by Hardy? Of course, you can write these formulas. They have polynomial. There are, you call it symmetric, yeah? There are three different types, 1, 2, 3, but these are equal. So it appears with coefficient 2. And Hardy was writing formulas which I just don't remember from high school about quadratic polynomials, which kind of all this kind of nonsense. You don't need it in a second, you see it, yeah? You don't have to know this multiplication table. It's completely kind of irrelevant, but also irrelevant. You understand much better if you forget about that. And here I write these formulas, and what he misses is, now let me explain what he misses, and what is the interesting map, and what kind of mathematics it brings in. And
you can ponder again about this mathematics. It's immediately also some of them full of unsolved questions, yeah. So yes, you imagine you don't quite know much about what was happening, but you know it must be a quadratic type of map. We have entity here, they mix together, so we multiply some quantities. So it's some quadratic map, the square of which must be identity. So let me show you such a map, and then we shall later I shall explain why it happens here. And the map will be quite simple. We define this map on matrices, where entries are numbers. By the way, what is a matrix? I challenge anybody here to give a definition of matrix. You know, people say matrix, mathematician, but there is no such object in mathematics, of course. Yeah? What is a matrix? Anybody can tell me what a matrix is? Mathematically, I mean, not just for mathematically. What is a matrix? Square table, you know what? Written on the blackboard by chalk or what? And this is the definition. This is a matrix. Yeah? And put here numbers, yeah? Right? And no, it's interestingly enough, yeah? It is not at all, you know, it's not simple. You cannot say it because we don't know it. Right? It's not because you just know how to say it. You don't know what it is, okay? That's why, again, it's like exactly, you know, greater, better than nothing. It's a confusion of the language. We're confused by images. We don't know what matrix is, but still we use this because it's so convenient, yeah? So we have row and columns. So we take a row, we take a column, we take all elements in the row, take their sum. Take all elements in the column, take their sum. Multiply them, you put them here. And this is polynomial map on matrices. I want to normalize it. So it will be not quite polynomial, it will be rational. I divide by the sum of all elements. Because these will be probability distributions. And I only can see the matrices with sum equals 1. And I divide by this sum to have always probability. And otherwise it wouldn't work, right? And so so on the space of these matrices, so say PQ, P elements here, Q there, I have the self-mapping. And the square of this mapping equals 2. That's the fact. Which is one of the way to express this Hardy-Weinberg theorem, and this is how it works, yeah? So we had kind of here fathers, here we have mothers, and we don't even assume symmetry, right? They mix their genes. This what will be new distribution. After mixing their genes, we repeat it twice, nothing happens. Of course, this, again, you can do it kind of without thinking, yeah? You try to imagine the simplest possible kind of combinational thing being multiplied. And this will be, of course, the simplest possible thing, yeah? Because all possible pairs of objects are matrices. You have, and this kind of operation kind of fosters you by pure logic, and in a way, if you think this what logic is, it is some underlying symmetry of the problem. There is built-in non-trivial symmetry in this problem. So Hardy was doing this for symmetric matrices 2x2. So something like, I think he was not, in his notation was like that. No, it was P, Q, I think it was R, P and R, something like that. He was doing it for this matrix. And taking, writing formula in this case explicitly in terms of P, Q, and R, and you have some kind of formula. But this is always true. So what is kind of interesting about this map, yeah? So one property of this, as I said, it is a
Russian lemma, because you multiply, in fact, by some of the elements, so degree goes up. But because you normalize, degree remains. So it's defined, in fact, in the projective space. And it's so you multiply a product of two projective spaces to projective space of higher dimensions. And instance of that is slightly, and this map was discovered by Veronese, and I forgot, and there was another name attached to it, Segre, I guess. And so let's just to have some feeling about this map. It's quite a remarkable map in many respects. So if you just look at this, yeah, you see a world of possibilities, a world of mathematics. If you look at this in geometric eyes, not like multiplication table. This, by the way, again, you can prove it by computation. I mean, it's kind of easy, but you don't have to compute again to prove it. You can prove it. It's seen from general principles, right? From nothing. If you this is still not the ultimate formulation to which I come, but I want to describe it in slightly better in one special case, and immediately see so what associated to this. And just look at it slightly again. Just my point is, you don't try to literally understand what is there. Just follow the spirit of that, right? And so, from something of strings, you get something quadratic. And very simple instance of that: if you have a linear form, say on the Euclidean space, linear function, take a square, and you have a quadratic function, and it means the space of linear function, which is Rn, goes to the space of quadratic function, which is the Euclidean space of a dimension, if I'm not mistaken, like that. Yeah, maybe slightly more, no? So you have such a polynomial map. You normalize it. In a second, I just give you one example. You don't remember the numbers. From R3 to R5. And you get, if you restrict it to the unit sphere, you have a map from the sphere to the five-dimensional space, where it is contained, in fact, in four sphere, yeah? And the map is symmetric, so actually it factors the projective space. So it gives you a very nice map from the sphere to five space. And in general, so it's highly symmetric, called Veronese variety. It's five. And what kind of properties it has? Again, you think about this map and just try to understand it. And I just want to say, it's just kind of, so again, the map is very simple. Yeah, you just take kind of covector linear form normalized to the norm one, take a square, become quadratic form. So it's space of quadratic form. It's a five-dimensional space, and just there will be again normalized. So sitting in this sphere. So how it looks like? So it's two sphere in five space, or in general, it's highly symmetric. So it's invariant under the action of the orthogonal group. So it's completely everywhere the same. There is a isometric group. So it's orbit of a symmetric power of the standard representation, right? So you take orthogonal group acts on linear forms, take symmetric, it's avoid x and quadratic polynomials, and so there is this particular orbit, which is projective space, but we think about this as sphere map there. But of course, it's an image of projective space. So it's fully symmetric. You may ask, are there other kind of objects of that type? Can you imagine another surface in R5 with this symmetry? Of course, surface itself must have comparable symmetry. The only surfaces having contingent full symmetry are tori. So you may ask if you can have torus sitting there with a comparable symmetry. So here the symmetry is fully orthogonal. And we just relax it maximally, but still we want to say it. We say, it will be symmetric, but only in the kind of weakest possible sense, which still relevant here. So we have surface just locally imagined, so it might be everywhere at the same point in five space. And you have another such piece of a surface. And so we say they're kind of equivalent. if there is a fine transformation, moving to this point, which preserve tangency up to second order. You always can make tangent space goes to tangent space. You always can do it. But I also want second derivative go to second derivative. Can you have this kind of symmetry? And it will be not degenerate, namely not sitting in a small space. So here, of course, you can do it because it's fully symmetric. But this is minimal you may expect for the two torus. And these are called free maps. So this question is there a free map of the two torus in five space? In simple terms, it means that if you take partial derivative of these maps, so there are five derivatives, two first derivative and three second derivatives. There are vectors here. These vectors should be independent. So this map F, if you take F1, F2, first derivative, and F1, F2, meaning derivative with respect to this coordinate, there are five maps. Five vectors here must be independent every point. If such a map exists, yeah? Again, there is a kind of story related to that, because there is a paper, famous paper by Moser, and just as one of the most cited papers in mathematics, when he generalizes Nash and Please function theorem, and as example he says, take such map, and when we read this article, we couldn't construct this map. It was Eli Ashberg, we studied this paper. And then I met Moser and asked him, do you know about this map? And he said, no, I don't know, I never thought about that yet. And still, of course, it's unknown. Such map exists, yeah. So, and from point of view, analysis and material, from point of view, the geometer, just everything is, this paper and Moser come infinitely simpler than this question. It's a really very hard question. We don't know if such map exists or not, right? And again, just my point is, you start with something like genetics, and you go a little bit further, just ask simple question, and you arrive at very profound mathematics and very difficult mathematics. Another point about the Sveranese maps, with Sveranese varieties, but they are remarkable from another perspective. And again, that was realized relatively recently, so the map, this. So the projective spaces inside of the Euclidean space of dimension, I think, maybe this, maybe something else. Yeah? If 5 equal 2 plus 3, no, something, not quite exactly this number. Yeah. Maybe plus minus 1 or something. Yeah. The dimensional homogeneous polynomial of degree 2 in n variables. And there was another problem for quite a while, and it was due to Borsuk, who proven, I believe the Borsuk proven, that if we have any subset in Euclidean space with diameter 1, we can divide it into 4 pieces of diameter less than 1. Say, in the plane, say, you can divide, say, circle, you cannot divide into 2 pieces of diameter less than 1, you'll be exactly the same as 1, but you can divide it into 3 pieces, yeah, of diameter less than 1. And any set in the plane divides into, it's easier, into 3 pieces of and then in 3 space, I don't remember whether Borsuk or somebody else proven, you can divide every set of diameter 1 in 4 pieces, and there was a conjecture for high dimensions, and then it was disproven by Kalai, and these are exactly counter examples. This set, if you look at them, it's obvious more or less, you need roughly exponentially many pieces. When you divide them smaller pieces, they have quite remarkable geometry, very simple, but very kind of complicated set of opposite points. So it depends how position the points of diameter 1, of max, and these are also count examples. So, I mean, this quite remarkable object in many respects. They really contradicts to naive mathematical intuition, and in this kind of Mendelian conclusion that something may stabilize in the second round of reproduction. You make selection, you do something, and then nothing happens afterwards. Everything stabilizes. It's really quite remarkable. Now, I said how to go without computations. What next level of mathematics? So what about matrices? Yeah, I had to explain what are matrices. Again, I'm saying there is no unique concept of a matrix. That's the whole point. In different contexts, they have different things. Now, in linear algebra, I want to define first what do you mean column and rows. Yeah, it's just arranged in a bunch of numbers. But how we think in modern terms? Yeah, just modern meaning late 19th century in set theoretic terms. So more modern terms will be categorical terms to which we turn. So we look at the set of all these objects. You know it's a vector space. But it's a vector space, but also, and this is what we're doing with that, we're taking some of these elements. So it's a vector space X together with a linear function from X, distinguished linear function to reals. Yeah? So it's a linear space with distinguished covector. Okay, and that will be for us rows, columns, whatever. So I call them space and I make this kind of scalar product with one vector. It's kind of not scalar product, but just linear functional. This is, for this, you can take tensor products. Because you can just multiply these functions. So it's closed under tensor products. So these tensor products are matrices, right? Because again, now they have the tensor product decomposition, and you have it. Now, what is this operation in these terms? So when you have this tensor product, what you can do, you can go to X. You just take vector this. So how you do that? You take X times Y. Right? So if you have element here, you just take this, because you create this will be number, right? Right? This is the value of your linear function. So you can project X, Y to X, and you can project it to here. So in general, tensor product, you cannot project it to its components. Yeah? There is no such thing as projection. That's one problem in the quantum mechanics. You cannot go to subsystem. You have system, you have two spaces representing your different quantum. You bring them together, become tensor product, you cannot go back. Because physicists say they're entangled. But of course, mathematicians said there is no canonical projection back. There is no canonical map. But if they come with this kind of distinguished thing, you can do it. Now, so what is our operation? I took this projection. Now I take this summation and this multiply them back. And then it's, the formula becomes kind of obvious. Yeah, it says that. It actually says how you put brackets, yeah? So if you have two, so you first project it and then take the tensor product back. Now, but because on the second round, your object already is a product, so it's meaning it being product, right? When you repeat it again, it will be the same product. Because if it was from the very beginning, it was X times Y. And now you apply this operation. It will be X times Y, and this will be X times Y. And if you take the tensor product, you get X times Y again, yeah? Because you normalize, yeah, I'm sorry, when you this make projection, you're normalized by this sum, right? So this will disappear because it makes normalization, so these terms disappear, so it remains the same. So square will be itself. There is nothing into computers, it's fully tautological. There is no computational, no discriminants, no nothing. All these are artifacts of poor notations of 19th century. Right. Actually, you know, Mendel had a pretty good education. He was studying physics with Doppler, or you know, for Doppler effect. And then there was another physicist less known, but who was trying to develop combinatorial models in physics. He was one of the, I forgot, he wrote kind of books about, I forgot his name, combinatorial models in physics. And from there, partly probably Mendel was inspired to make this thing in there. So this is what we have here, and this is completely kind of simple. And
And so just no computation at all. Yeah, I mean, just pure tautology, how it should be. Yeah, right. Simple thing must be simple. Yeah, they don't computation. Sometimes it happens, of course. There's some unexpectedly out of complicated computation. But it's so rare. I mean, it's a double miracle, so we don't usually expect it. Now I want to make a little turn. Yeah, maybe I want to make 5 minutes break, because now I'll turn to entropy, and so let's make 5 minutes break. Now, who wants to go? And here I have some, very few of them, papers. One of the thicker one, where I speculate on something which I cannot prove. We'll come back in 5 minutes. Okay, so I say just a few words, continue. So on a technical level, I shall go into this in the following lecture. So the essential map was that I have a row here, I have a column here, and I multiply them, and I have this kind of matrix. And this is a map from product of two linear spaces to there. This is the standard map corresponding to tensor product, which has quite amusing properties. And there were kind of several layers of that. And so to which I will converge, not today, but I just want to say, is the following, when you start kind of, again, relax and generalizes maximally, you arrive at the situation of the following type. When you have, say, commutative algebra, topological algebra, for example, maybe in this example, it will be algebras of truncated polynomials. So you can find dimension algebras, but maybe more general algebras, and you do the following thing. On one hand, you have algebras, and you have some number of endomorphisms. And it will be quite simple here. You just restrict your polynomial to some subspaces, and then extend them by zero whenever possible. Then you take multiplicative endomorphism, which will be certain product of this phi j. When you multiply them, you get multiplicative endomorphisms. And then thirdly, you take the linear combination. Certain linear combinations. So that gives you a class of transformation. By now, they are not endomorphism of these algebras. So in relevant examples, there will be this rational transformations. It will be a rational transformations or polynomial transformation in the space of truncated polynomials. But this quite interesting also for such algebras like algebra of function with convolution. For example, and this generalization of this Hardy-Wieden principle, that in very many cases, such a transformation, many cases which are explicitly describable, usually describable in terms how this endomorphism act on the spectrum of this algebra. If this dynamics is simple, it's pretty often these dynamics are simple. And simple, I mean that they have a fixed point, either attractive or where a repelling part can be described, where the simplest and most famous instance of that is the normal law. Yeah, the fact that when you convolve random variable with itself many times and normalize, you converge to normal distribution is instance of that. Yeah. So, and Mendelian dynamics is another instance of that, and there are other examples in genetics, in what's so-called formal genetics, because real genetics, of course, nothing is so simple, transformation is much more complicated, but still the core of that is, and this happens in, again, if you look at your model situation, more general than the one which I described, namely, you have not one gene, but you have many genes, It's one point. And secondly, when it is not a diploidal organism, when there are only two copies of each chromosome and organ, but several, you arrive in this more general picture when you have this endomorphism of polynomial, truncated polynomial algebras this kind of maps, and then you can prove there are these fixed point properties similar to the law of, the law of the normal central limit theorem, whatever it's called. So this is one line of thinking, but there is another one much more in the same respect, which I just was mentioning, and this you associate to the name of Morgan and Sturtevant, where mathematics is much more kind of less well-shaped and therefore more interesting. When you remember that you by, from these statistics, in this statistic you encode or reconstruct also geometry of the of chromosome. So we know today by molecular biology that genes sits in DNA, and DNA comes in strings. They're polymer, they're one-dimensional molecules, and this is the most essential feature of life. It's one-dimensionality. This is where mathematics enters. For some reason, life is one-dimensional, right? It's encoded by something one-dimensional because chemically it's impossible to make something heteropolymer multidimensional. But before it was discovered experimentally in molecular biology, it was shown by Sturtevant by Mendelian type of experiments. So what is a Mendelian, which was done by Morgan, not with, who developed all these techniques and developed overall picture by making experiment with Drosophila. They're small kind of flies, which you can breed them very fast. You develop, you make these pure breeds, which have certain feature being repeated, and then you start mixing them, and you see how different features are being distributed, right? And so look at the statistics. And from that, Sturtevant concluded that genes lie on the line. So these features you observe typically the shape of the wings, the color of the eyes, three more characteristic, and the stripes on their bodies. I think these are three first thing which he's done. And you can say the line on the line, and that one of them in between the two. So the basic relation here is between. Line is not a metric line, nor it is ordered line. It's a between relation. So, and you can say V gene lies between other genes. Though genes were quite abstract, and Morgan himself was emphasizing that it's a material for what is the nature of these genes, whether they, what are their kind of molecular nature. Is that there may be transcendental features, and what he says is that between the genes, which genetics study, and the phenotype you observe, there is a world of embryonic development. And so immensely complicated, so it's completely irrelevant what you know about genes, you know, to say how they relate. Yeah. And this is still almost true today. Yeah. And this is, by the way, he was hated, I think, in Soviet Russia because it was considered an idealistic statement. Yeah. Because he didn't care about kind of material nature of genes. Though he perfectly, of course, understood that there must be some hidden molecular biology, but it was not his business. And Sturtevant, who was a student at that time, he was about 19 years, 20 years old, and he made this conclusion from the experiment, and this was called linkage done by Morgan, that there are this linear structure in genes. And this, I think, is quite remarkable, that you look at statistics of something, and you can reconstruct geometry. And the only example I know where it was considered before, maybe there are others, and as you point out, right? And in one of his books, I've forgotten which of them, either it was Science and Method or Science and Hypothesis, he wrote these two books. He looks at another question. He certainly didn't know about genetics. But he speaks about geometry. And we know the world we live in has certain symmetry, and kind of the tricky symmetry is this one. Yeah. It's a simple Lie group. It's kind of very kind of complicated object. It's a kind of atom, which is not divisible into anything, right? Unlike other, the first truly kind of new phenomenon in group theory. It's not compact, not simple Lie, first compact, simple Lie group. Yeah, if you forget about this we have taken double covering here. And how we can manage to reconstruct it? We live in this world, and we turn around, but we see the same world. How could it be? How can we match images? Yeah, you turn and you see the same thing. Because what comes to your eye will be nothing, yeah? So you have here, you moved it, and these two functions are not close. And it's, again, people who are analyzing images, till recently, they just could not even conceive that because they were analytically minded. They're always comparing images by taking their difference and looking at the difference. But you move this image to this position, they're maximally separated. However, it's the same image. Only for the last 10 to 20 years, people arrived to this understanding that Poincaré had, you know, more than 100 years before. So how it can be? Yeah? And essentially, Poincaré suggested the same way, the same model, the same kind of presentation of geometric structures. So I just say it, and then I will elaborate on this later on. So what is geometric structure? So without saying what structure you construct, what you see and how you want to reconstruct it. Yeah? So you have a set with geometric structure. And you don't know what structure is, but what you know, right? For example, look at the images. For images, it's kind of clear, right? Forget about dimension 3. Just look at dimension 2. And imagine you are shown images on the screen. But the screen itself has no geometry. So you just screen, and there are pixels, and they're somehow enumerated. So you have, you have like 200 by 200 screen, let's simplify it, let it be 1,000 by 1,000. So you have 2 to the 6 entries, and they may be either black and white. So we have a sequence of black and white. Yeah. They enumerate in a certain way, always you enumerate a pixel, and each image, it's a million of dots, black, white, black, and you imagine you have, say, a million of such pictures, right? So each of them is a sequence, yeah, this is what comes to your brain, yeah? Right, your brain is just essentially linear, there is no kind of dimensionality in it. So the problem is as follows, again, I repeat, you have million of strings, each of them, well, maybe million, just not to confuse numbers, imagine you have more of them. You have 10 to the 7 strings of the lengths to 10, each 10 to the 6, yeah. You have lots and lots of them, each of these lengths, and there's black and white. I purposely don't say 0 and 1. People just say, say 0 and 1. I don't want to say it, I don't know what numbers are. Numbers are an immensely complicated thing, yeah, that is black and white. And once you say numbers, you immediately make all mistakes. People exactly were doing that, making numbers, they tend to add them, subtract them, which is not relevant here. They're just black and white dots. How can you say that this is pictures of the world with in dimension 2, with Euclidean symmetry? Right? That's the question. And Poincaré kind of analyzes this question and he suggests something which I explain more, what he says more than I'm going to say. And the same, what is Sturzevant does, in fact. But how you would do that? This kind of purified question, yeah? Can you do that? Is it possible? In principle, yeah? To say, but again, the point is, I take pictures from the real world. They're not any sequences. The sequences, I took a screen, I take arbitrary enumeration, a very idiotic one, I don't know what. But then I take real photos of this room, of this world, of the sky, of people, of faces, whatever, and not just random distributions. And if they're random, they're random. Yeah? If they're just random, poof, you have noise. Nothing you do, you always have noise. Yeah? But like, from the real world. And I say, yes, you can. You can, looking at them, say they're coming for images, and you can actually construct the screen. You know what the screen is, and then really project them and to see these images back. You can find what the numeration was. How? Exactly using this idea of Sturzevant, which is Poincaré made next step. Actually, Poincaré reasoning was two step. Sturzevant made only first step because his geometry was simple. And you do, as I said, the essential thing, it came from the real world. And so what does it mean, the real world? And the essential thing of the real world that it kind of very, and there is very little variety in this, yeah? Things tend to repeat. Namely, if you look at the image of something, say black and white, and you take a point, and it's black. Then you take point nearby, probability it's black is very high. Right? Boundaries are small, and interiors are big. So if you have any image, and you look at some point, and you look nearby, with very high probability, by far exceeding what happens far away, it will be the same color, will be the same as the original point. Right? And this is a kind of basic fact of life from which allows us to operate in this world. If not, we would be, you know, we wouldn't exist here. Nothing could be possible. And this is not the only feature of the world, but this is a basic feature which we exploit. Once you know that, you look at this correlation function between two points, and out of this somehow you make distance. Right? So it's function in two variables, correlation between two points. So we have these numbers, you take number, so it's million of them, you take, I don't know, number 10 to the 4, and number 7 times 10 to the 4. There is some correlation of colors, you put it there. So I give you function and two variables in the space of these things. And you make some function of that, you call it distance. So now in your set of sequences, you have a distance function, and then you observe that it's symmetric. Well, approximately, of course, with respect to the symmetry group, and there is unique, essentially, representation up to rotation of this on the screen. If it happened, probability of this being accidental exponentially small. Of course, it may not happen. And if it doesn't happen, well, nothing, so your approach was wrong. But amazingly how often it works. And when it works, you know it works. And this exactly was Surichevant done in a slightly different terms. You look at this conjectural gene, they have unknown geometry. Again, I'm saying not exactly what he's done for. You make this correlation function, and look at this space with this geometry, and see it's a line, right? Just from correlation between points, and you, of course, it's not like that, not that simple, for many reasons. In a way, it's more simple, in a way, it's less simple, because he doesn't reconstruct geometry as metric. It's only geometry of in-between geometry. He knows who between whom. He needs less. On the other hand, there's kind of, the things are less, well, what I say would work if this thing were rather independent, whatever. But that's the first step in this logic of Poincaré and Surichevant. And of course, if you try to do this in the real world, I guess your brain wouldn't do that. Yeah. So nobody knows if there is a plausible algorithm doing that in a realistic time. So if you do, the algorithm comes, yes, you come to one's mind, you'll go, you know, exponentially long time. There is a kind of shortcut, and Poincaré suggests some idea how they may go. And essentially, it's because you move. And it's because you can make experiment. You can interact with the environment. And that makes mathematics more sophisticated, and it's not quite known. But now I want to turn the last 10 minutes to return to the simplest aspect of this Mendel and see what else, where else it brings you. So, and this, as I said, was multiplication of entries here. You have entry AI, entry BJ. I hate this notation, yeah, because they're meaningless. I and J symbol, they're not numbers, yeah? And here this multiplies, you have CIJ equal AI by BJ. Again, because, as I said before, there is no such thing as a matrix. Yeah? This is just a word. It's not a mathematical object. However, it's very hard not to use it. Yeah? Actually, I don't know how to live without it, without column vectors and row vectors, okay. But matrix are so handy for some reason, yeah? Because you write on two-dimensional space, of course. Not for any deep mathematical reason. So we have this map. So what? And so you have these matrices of special kind, matrices of rank one, right? So they're product of column by rows. And so in the space of all matrices of order, say, PQ, there is subspace of PQ of matrices of rank one. namely those which are product of column rows. And this is an instance of one of those Segre Albanese Veronese variety. But what they are from kind of statistical point of view, if you a little bit know elementary probability, and these entries are positive numbers with normalized sum equals one, so what you have, so these are now simplices of dimension p and q, and so you have a product of these two simplices, which maps to the simplice of dimension pq. So it's a rather tricky object sitting inside. Inside of this simplice, you have a curved surface in a very intricate way. And so what is what, and it's kind of equilibrium position, what people may say in statistics, and it has, it's related to the entropy in the following way. So now entropy enters. And so this subset is extremal set for the so-called Shannon inequality. Now everything I was describing in this Mendelian dynamics is actually like statistical mechanics. It exactly follows the rules, entropic rules. Entropy goes up, you just take random processes and they mix them up, and just it's like very much like in many physical and chemical dynamics where entropy goes up, and in particularly here, this kind of, there is entropy behind it, and so, and the map, this Mendelian map in the space of genes increases entropy and Moreau brings it to its maximal value. So this equilibrium states, which I said, your mixed population, if you have only deployed organism and you look at only one gene, after the first generation, you arrive at equilibrium, and this equilibrium characterized by having maximal entropy. Right? So whenever you have statistical equilibrium, immediately entropy comes to my mind. And this was one of the things which was studied by Fisher. And so what is entropy? Now I want to say, let's extend, so in another 5 minutes, how you think in relaxed term also about entropy. So 19th century entropy. So actually the boundary, it's not 19th century, it's something I would say 1950, where kind of a mathematic changed. Yeah, it's very much due to the work of Grothendieck, when it's moved, went beyond multiplication table. So before that, it was mainly multiplication table. There were little indication here and there, but basically it was multiplication table. And then it changed. Yeah, and so, in particular about entropy. So how you think about entropy, not in terms of a multiplication table. So in terms of a multiplication table, and this was a definition due to Shannon and just following, of course, Boltzmann and Gibbs, it was the following expression. And kind of essential contribution of Shannon, I'm joking a little bit, putting here a log on base 2, yeah, instead of natural log, but we don't care. So pi are numbers. So in terms of numbers, they are positive numbers. Sum of pi is equals 1. And you write this expression, and then you use different notation, which I hate because you never remember them. This entropy, the whole thing, you call this p, this bunch of numbers. The order is a material because it's symmetric. So entropy over p is a number attached to this collection. So what it is, and what it has to do with this Segre Albanese varieties. So I want to define entropy in categorical terms. So again, so it must be something, and we know it a posteriori, something remarkable associated to this bunch of numbers. And everything remarkable must have simple, has many kind of many properties which come together, which are kind of rather incredible. There's so many properties one entity may have, which I don't want to discuss. This is kind of secret motivation, but pretending you only know there may be there, you don't know there, you want to define it. First, what about this a range of numbers? From a point of view of kind of geometry of naive set theory, if you have these numbers I taken from some index set, you have a simplex in the Euclidean space as a by. This is another point I just hate to write, so you do it like r to the n, yeah? It's completely meaningless notation, yeah? If you try to analyze it, it's unclear what you mean. It's set. This makes sense, yeah? You have set, and you take finite set, you take all the real valued functions on the set, and then you have the space. But what is n? N is not a set, so you cannot say what's r to the power n, right? So, but this makes sense, and this simplex there, and this particular set enumerating it. And you can say, these are just points here. It's one point of view. But there is another way to think about that. If you take a categorical point of view, you say, whatever in the world, not a set, it must be a category. And indeed, yes, but this points, they are not just different points. They're related to each other. And when they're related to each other, the set changes. It's not the same set, right? Here you have immediately something you're uncomfortable because the set is specified, but maybe different sets, right? They're just set. They're not just 1, 2, 3, n or whatever. It may be tables, maybe genes, maybe whatever. They're just sets, and how these different things are related. Even the number is a variable. And the point is that finite probability spaces, or infinite, whatever, but finite, make a category. You have there is a well-defined notion of morphism between the two. And this is a super simple concept, because if you think about them, and that's kind of a good way to think, much better than any kind of formalism, it's a bunch of stones of different weight, which you normalize total weight to be one. And the morphism you allow, you bring some of them together, and they add, thing adds up. They only become bigger, of course. And these are your morphism. It's kind of super simple, and you may think it's even stupid, because it's just because there is essentially a unique error between two spaces. Well, not quite unique. Sometimes there are several, yeah, but typically they're unique, right? So what's the point to say error? Why not to write just at p bigger than q? So, and this is what usually people do. In measure theory, they use this notation saying one sigma algebra bigger than another sigma algebra, blah, blah, blah. And there is a very funny reason, which I think extremely kind of notationally significant. Because, specifically when you speak about entropy, and this will be relevant, you can write entropy of f. Whatever it is, it makes sense. But you cannot say entropy of this sign. Because in order to say it, you have to put here both p and q. And then you say it will be relative entropy of p with respect to q. You have to remember who with respect to whom. And that, I think, is impossible. Right? When it is relative, it's just wrong. It's indicating it's of wrong relation. And this is very convenient. And in fact, relative entropy of a morphism. Immediately, by the way, if you have entropy of an object, you know there must be entropy of a morphism. Now, what kind of simpler thing you can assign to a category? So you have a category, and you assign something new to this category. And there is a very simple kind of rule. You don't think about that. You say, even any category, you take Grothendieck group of this. Which actually, in this case, will be a priori semigroup, but you can extend it to a group. Given any category, you can make a billion group or semi-group of this, and this is a very simple rule. If you go arrow A, B, C, you say element to this arrow, to this arrow will be alpha and beta, and to this combination, to composition you assign the sum. Right? So you can abelianize your category and take the semi-group. Then you can insist it being a group, and in this case it will be semi-group. So do that. Of course, this is the topological category. So the objects here, and this is kind of as often happens, yes, you don't use algebra on the algebra, you remember a little bit of geometry or analysis. It's topological category, so you have to do it in topological sense, which requires certain effort, which I don't explain again on my next lecture. And once this being done, you have your definition, because if you do it like that, you have a huge group. It will be a very, very big group, yeah, like an uncountable group, which is no good. So you have to make it topologically. And when you make it topologically, you obtain certain group or semigroup, and then you think a little bit and realize that this group or semigroup equals to multiplicative group of real numbers greater or equal than one. It's semigroup, yeah? So numbers bigger than one make the semigroup multiplicatively. And the reason for that, why this abstract Grothendieck group happens to be equal to the semigroup, is just the law of large numbers. You just go through all this definition, you formally apply it, and ta-da-da, by continuity you go to some limit, and in this limit you apply this Bernoulli theorem, and you arrive at that, and we take log of this. And there is, again, non-trivial reason for taking this log. It's not at all apparent why you should take log, right? And then you get usual up to normalization, you get entropy. So entropy is just log of the value of this in this Grothendieck group. And this, of course, advantage is because the formula, sum of pi log pi, come a posteriori. You know, and then you can prove. It's really given very easy once you know what I said, once you know these functorial properties. And actually, it's immediately act not only for object, but also for morphisms. So I give you entropy, give you relative entropy. And then it applies, in fact, in the situation slightly more general than I said, and the full extent of this definition is unclear. When you start thinking further, it immediately brings you to the domain where things become rather unclear. And this is what I will pursue. So I finish this in my following lecture, then I come back from this perspective, look at the Mendelian dynamics. But again, my point is that you can see different things if you look from mathematics, I'm saying second half of the 20th century, compared to the multiplication table type mathematics. See, Hardy is kind of funny. He's making fun of what he does. But again, from the perspective of today, he's almost 99% multiplication table kind of mathematician. Yeah, he was doing always his numbers. He was playing with numbers all his life. Not his kind of more combinatorial or geometric quantities, which he just apparently was missing. And that is a kind of characteristic, so that eventually you come to numbers, eventually, maybe not, like Maxwell was suggesting. Maybe not, because in these two papers, which I brought to you, that's exactly instances when the number seems to be not appropriate. That numbers only, in this example, numbers still serve you very well, but then when you go to the next level, to the other structure, it's not so clear. Okay, so for today, I finished.